Hello everyone and welcome to a new episode of Startup Zone Talk. So today here I'm with a new guest. I'm with Mehdi Hassan. He's the co-founder of MyCash Online, the e-marketplace for migrants. So thank you very much for coming, Hassan, and welcome to our show.
Yeah, thanks a lot for inviting me. So I'm very happy to be here.
We are also very happy. For a long time, I wanted to meet you. Okay, so I will start with my traditional question.
Sure.
I want to know if you can tell us about your background. Let's say, what type of kid you were back in school, in university also, how did you do, what is your major?
Okay, actually I'm from Bangladesh. So I studied in army school in my childhood. So the school was like a little bit, you know, the it's like British public school.
Okay.
Like you need to stay in the hostel, so you need to do all the physical exercise and all these things. It was very much fun, but that age was like, feel like it's a torture, you know.
Okay.
So, but the things they teach me that time, like, you know, that all the public speaking, so the extracurricular activities, that was like, during that time, maybe we felt like it's not necessary or it's it's too much, but now I feel like that was a good thing. We have gone through that.
And that type of school is very different from the other
public
school.
That is because these schools are a bit privileged school, you know, because it's government funded and we don't need to pay for almost anything, man. So everything is paid by government. They give you dresses, they give you food, 5 times a day, place to stay, your tuitions, everything. So
is there like a criteria to be able to join?
This is a very difficult process to join. Like you have a written test, physical test, then the medical test, and Viva, few types of tests, and every year thousands of students actually try to apply. And from there, actually, they take it. We have around 10, 13 school, 10 for boys, 3 for girls in Bangladesh. So they will take every school, they take only 50 students. So it's a very big competition. So I was lucky enough to
be able to
join that. Join the school.
But let's say, how did you do in the school?
Where I did quite okay. I was a prefect also, and I was I was cultural prefect for 1 year, the final year. So, and then I did my school leaving exams. I did very, very good results actually. So that helps. The school actually helps to do that actually. Yeah.
Okay. Did you have siblings?
Yeah, I have one sibling.
So you are the eldest, youngest?
Right? I'm the elder.
The elder. Okay.
I have only one. He's my brother.
Oh,
actually,
okay.
So he's a doctor, and now he's working with me actually.
In MyCash Online.
Yeah, it's MyCash Online. Okay. He's helping on the marketing side.
Okay. Then in university, where did you study?
University, I initially started in Bangladesh, but after a few semesters, I felt like it's not going very well because of the job market and other things. So I thought I was trying to go outside, like study in UK or other European country, but unlucky things, like, you know, my university year was 2001, the, you know, the 9/11 year. So after that, as a Muslim student, it was impossible for me to go to anywhere actually.
I
applied a few countries and all get rejected. Then I was thinking I need to do something, maybe then in Malaysia, the Muslim country, then being that was easy for Muslim guys to come. Then so we applied and I came to Malaysia and studied in APIT.
Which year that one?
APIT in Bukit Jalil.
Okay. I think a lot of us came through because I also studied in APIT, but I'm in end of 2005.
Okay.
So 2 years maybe after.
So I think almost similar times. Yeah. A lot of students. That time, I think APIT was a very glamorous university actually. Even now, I think a lot of foreign students there.
A lot. I think I talked to them. I hear that majority of students now are foreign students. Maybe because
their branding and branding.
Attracting, I think it was also a policy for the Ministry of Higher Education to bring more foreign students to Malaysia.
Yeah, they promote the university, actually, the school universities.
Okay, now I want to talk about your startup, My Cash Online.
Yeah, sure.
So can you tell me the story of My Cash Online?
Okay, so it goes back to the happy days. Once I finished my studies, actually before I finished studies, I was talking with a few companies to work with, like software engineers. So I eventually started working in a company that's also from a guy from Epic, actually. He's an Epic ex student. So I started with working with him, so in PGA. So in 2006-07 I started a full-time job actually as a PHP developer. So during that time we have developed so many softwares, apps, all these things for many clients actually. So during that time I also worked with DG some projects actually. So so in 2012 I left that company and I joined another company. So that company was a DG direct venture to develop softwares actually for. And that time I was assigned to develop some product for migrant workers actually for DG customers. You know, DG has the largest base of migrant workers even now actually.
Okay.
So a lot of prepaid users are migrants actually. So and DG is the prepaid only telco there. So like the Maxis or Cellcom, they have larger amount of postpaid user, but DG is prepaid user.
The largest prepaid user.
Yeah.
And a lot of those prepaid users, so, I guess, foreigners and migrants.
Yeah, foreigners and migrants, yes, exactly. Because Malaysians, they like to use postpaid and pay monthly bills, actually. So during that time, we have developed so many products, like SMS services, and mainly SMS and IVR, like voice response-based services. You can call a number, listen music, and call number. These services was very popular. And then actually, 2014, I actually assigned to Myanmar.
Okay.
So because that time, the Telenor, they started to start services. They just beat a license in Myanmar.
Okay.
Because before that, there's no telcos actually. So I still remember the first time I went to Myanmar, there was no mobile network actually.
Really?
Yeah.
In 2014?
2013 or something like that.
Around
They have mobile network only for the government one, but that is very difficult to get a SIM card. So I have seen a lot of people, they have a mobile phone but they don't have a SIM card, because SIM card you need to buy a lottery or something like that. That was that one time. And so that time they give license to Ooredoo and also Telenor. So they came and they changed everything in Myanmar. So
just to tell our audience, Telenor is the, I think it's a Swedish company.
It's not Norwegian company. They are Norwegian parent company.
They are the parent of DG and
the German phone in Bangladesh also, and Telenor Myanmar. So they even DTAC in Thailand. So they have lots of business. So so I was then working with the Telenor in Myanmar to develop.
But based from Malaysia or you went?
Based to Malaysia.
Based on
but
Malaysia.
I was visiting frequently every month, few times.
Okay.
Yeah, I felt like I was like almost. A lot of people know me still nowadays in Myanmar that I've been there so many times.
Okay.
So after that, in 2014, I was like having some discussion with DG. Some teams, they are telling me that we are going to digital soon. We'll stop digital SMS services soon. So then I was thinking, okay, then I think I move on now to do something myself. Like I start doing apps.
Okay.
Because I thought that that would be the big thing, the next big thing for them. Even for the migrant community, because even the telcos, Digitel, you know, they're stopping all these SMS-based services, they are moving to app-based services. And I thought as a technology person, it's an opportunity for me to develop something of my own. So in end of 2014, I resigned from my jobs and I started to do a music app for the migrants actually. So, we did that, we got some initial funding on this thing, so it was doing quite well. So in that time I met my co-founder Noor actually. His name is Noor, so he's also from Bangladesh. So he was working in Dubai in Western Union. So he was a money service guy, so he came to Malaysia to work with one company, then we meet sometimes. So we were discussing that he was telling me that you are doing apps on this thing. So why don't we do an app for the migrants that can send money or something like that, or sell to them top-ups or this thing, because he saw that he got this experience from the
from working in Western Union.
Yeah, working in Western Union, but there is nothing available there. So then we thought, okay, it's a good idea, maybe we can start it. So 2015, end of the 2015, we registered MyCash as a company. But we started our business in 2016, April, we started.
Okay.
So we take around 6 months for us to register a company, opening bank account. You know, it takes time as a foreigner, so all these things.
Actually, this is what I want. How difficult was that?
Opening company is quite okay, but I think for bank account opening is difficult. So you need to. How long it took you? We need to change the directors actually, we need to put local directors to open bank account. But then again, actually, to, frankly speaking, it's not Malaysian problem. See, Singapore, we actually face the same problems. We face the same problem in Australia also.
Okay.
Even I know a company, I cannot name the company. They got a remittance license in Australia, it's a Malaysian startup. But they didn't manage to open a bank account. So how bad is that actually?
I think this is the banking system they lack in behind, because in my startup, it took me more than 3 months to open the bank account. Yeah, you open the company in few days, maybe a week. Opening the bank account, it took me, I think, 3 to 4 months.
Yeah, it's difficult because the companies, like even Singapore, we still don't have an account in DBS. We try many times actually. Even we got a recommendation from MAS and other organizations still, but DBS still say that you're none of the directors in Singaporean, none of the directors stay in Singapore.
But, so. But I have one director, a Malaysian, and it took me 3 months.
I know. Yeah, there's similar things actually. So we need to actually put my wife as a director and then and pass everything.
Your wife is Malaysian?
Yeah, so then we settle these things. But I think it's pretty much normal. So, but it's actually, that's what we are doing now. We are changing this banking thing. We don't, one day I think you not need banking account now when the transfer to or Revolt, all these things.
And I think it's worth mentioning, most of the migrants also, they don't have a bank account. It's very difficult for them to get financial services.
Yeah, it is actually.
So you saw the gap there.
There's the opportunities actually. So I don't feel bad about that actually. It's an opportunity. And because why I don't feel bad about that? Because opening a bank account for migrants actually is not very beneficial for him.
For the bank or for both parties.
Okay. Because why? Because the banking system is designed for a Malaysian, is a quite rich Malaysian actually, not for a 200 ringgit earning foreigner. So like in Singapore actually, we have foreigner, we have foreign customers, we have, they have actually bank account, but they don't use it actually, they just, what they get salary, they go to ATM booth, withdraw the money. Because why? Because the DBS account they have, it's actually not for them. The every services they have, they give, if you use the 3 times more, they give you discount to buy a Starbucks. So this type of, you know, the offering, the presentations, everything is not for them actually. So that's why the, from the day one, they feel the bank account is a, something is not, you know, they
are, it's not designed for them. It does not help them.
Even even in Australia, I have customer. They don't like bank account actually, because the charges. Because if you send money from Australia to Bangladesh, it, they take $30, you know.
Okay, and that's a lot for...
It's a lot. We charge them only $3.
Okay, let's say if I want to compare the bank account services or some services like Western Union and MyCash Online, how, what is your advantages? What problem you are solving?
Okay, actually it depends on country to country. Like if you think about like Australia, in Australia, MyCash is a fully functional remittance company. We are as good as Western Union, so I can fight you every day there actually. But in Malaysia, we don't. We work with partners, like a few partners actually.
Why? So, is it the license?
Yeah, it's difficult to get a license here actually. So there's a lot of requirements, like so we are not yet trying to get a license, but we are already become agents of few remittance companies, but in Australia we have a license. So in Singapore we already applied on the day actually. It will take some time. So so when it comes to like, if you go to the Australian market, so our like three things you can compare: charges, how much they charge. So if you go, most of the people, they send money from the bank. Like from you and you, they go to maybe to you and send money. So then Australia, if you go to the NAB or the Commonwealth Bank or ANZ Bank website and send, if you try to send money, it will take $30, $25 charges. But if you go to Western Union, they'll charge you around $10. But you need to go, to their booth or their agent shop. But on the other hand, if you use MyCash, we'll charge you around $3 to $5 of
much less.
And it's automated. You do never need to come. We don't have an office.
Okay. So everything from the app, from the website?
So all you need to go to, I'm telling about our Australian app actually. So you need to download the apps, you need to put your face selfie, your documentation, ID, and also a proof of your address actually, like a bill, utility bill or insurance or something. These three things, if you upload, we verify, you open your account, you can then send money actually.
Okay, cool. And how MyCash Online is sustaining? Is it, are you bootstrapping? Did you get funding?
We got some funding in 2017 actually. So half a million ringgit we raised in Malaysia. After that, currently we're self, we are profitable actually. And we have around 20 staff and we are operating in three countries actually.
Okay. I want to go in one question a little bit back. When you started MyCash Online, let's say how your parents' reaction, did they support you or did they doubt?
I think, I don't know about your country, or, but our country actually, people still feel safe for if you work for somebody else. Doing business, they feel like, you know, that you can't do a job properly. So you're doing something that nobody wants to do or something like that. So initially they were a little bit worried, like still there, I think still they're a little bit worried.
They're still worried until now?
Is it really necessary? You can't get a job in a good company or something like that. Like,
How did you like explain to them, or how did you, you know, fight that?
I told them that let me try. If really I cannot do, I can anytime I can go back to job. Shouldn't be a problem. But they still there. Sometimes they very worried about me. So that is it a good thing you are doing or not? So, but it's okay. But their parents, you know, they think our betterment. It's again. You cannot say like which one is good, which one is bad. So entrepreneurship,
there is a pros and cons.
Like entrepreneurship is sometimes I feel very good actually. It's like you can do whatever you want actually. But then again, you see like how you are working the weekend also. You need to come to office, like all these things. And so that is the things actually. Like you need to work more when you work for yourself actually.
And I think you also enjoy the journey. It's not really sometimes about the result. Maybe when you're working for a company, you make more money than doing your own business. But the journey is different. Like you wake up every day excited instead of working every day.
Sometimes actually I feel also like you're doing business. I don't know how you feel, but sometimes I also feel tired. This actually, maybe I think somewhere like end of this year, maybe I should do something else or take a break or something like that, like because sometimes I feel like that also.
I think that's normal. Sometimes you go to burn out, sometimes you doubt yourself, but there is something always keep you pushing.
Of course, like what I feel like now we have around 20 people in our team. So one good thing, every day I think like these families are depend on me actually. So I need to run the company. I need to
feel responsible.
Ensure that they get salary every month. Their families are running on my shoulder actually. So there is more responsibility than and alhamdulillah now we are able to actually sustain and we give them bonuses and also there is a good growth in team in their benefits and other things.
So you have
20.
20 staff.
Yeah.
How many founders, co-founders you have?
Actually, mainly three of us, me, Noor, and my wife.
Three. And what is, if you can tell me, maybe how is the culture of working in MyCash Online?
Well, MyCash is an open office concept we have. So we don't have many, lots of positions or levels. So everybody like me, my co-founders, and my even my junior staff, we sit same table, we do the same jobs. I also take care of the customer service sometimes. So we have a very, very plain company. So there's no boss, no staff type of relationship.
Not a lot of levels in organization charge. So almost everybody. I think in a startup level, I think if you have more than one level, there's too much bureaucracy there.
It's really difficult. So.
Okay. Okay, we don't have much time, so I will go quickly through some of the... this topic I think is very important.
Sure.
The Malaysian government announced they are planning to cancel Category 3 and Category 4 visas for the expatriates. So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, actually...
From, let's say, from foreigner or from expatriate point of view?
Actually, like companies like us, we need for foreign workers, actually, foreign staffs. Because I need like my customer target customer base and migrant market to communicate with them. Actually, I need a marketing team. They speak their language.
Okay.
Maybe from Bangladesh, Pakistan, or India or Indonesia. So I need them. So definitely, I can't pay them 10,000 and let them do the job.
Yes, because and the locals cannot do that.
And the locals cannot do that also because we need the. That communication skills, the language, culture, all these things. So I hope that the government will consider this as a case-to-case basis, but not a generalized things. But because why the government is coming to this actually, because there's a lot of cases of abuse of these visas. So people actually, they just get a visa, but they don't work, they do business, all these sort of things. If any, we go to Savage Agency. A lot of examples actually.
Okay, I actually am not aware of that.
Yeah, there's a lot of abuses I saw actually.
But I think they can tackle those issues.
Yeah.
On not the cancel the whole.
Thing. Yeah. So because cancellation maybe it's not enough.
Do you think it will affect the industry, especially for startups?
Yeah, of course, definitely. Because then we need to find out something alternative. Like maybe I need to do the. I put the teams in some other place and do WhatsApp marketing like that. Because I know because I'm quite involved in the Malaysian tech scene, startup scene actually. I have seen a lot of Malaysian startups, they hire foreigners actually.
Yeah.
From Vietnam, from India, especially from India. Even banks, like big banks in Malaysia, there's a lot of IT for people from India actually. So if they're visas are cancelled like this, so maybe either they will move to Bangalore or Chennai or something like that.
So I think worth mentioning, according to Bank Negara Malaysia, the unemployment rate in between Malaysian is just 3.3%. So for me, I don't see there is an issue that you have to take foreigners' jobs to give it to locals, because the unemployment rate is very good actually. If you compare it within the neighbor countries, within worldwide rate, I think it's doing very well.
Yeah, but if still government feels like insecure, they can actually make some jobs not for foreign, like Singapore, like they have the regulation that like certain job you can't hire foreigners. Like they can do like that actually.
I think they should also look at the data and see what
so
sectors.
For us, we just need for technical people.
Yeah, technical. I think
technical
we need
jobs,
the foreigners.
Yeah, we need, and maybe for the like the
marketing,
cases like marketing where they need the language.
The language barrier, the
call
culture,
centers, all these things. So only for this. Sector, other than other sector, being stopped actually.
Okay, because we're running out of the time. I think before I go to my last question, do you have any advices for the young entrepreneurs who are just starting, or for someone like still in university and planning to be a founder? What is your advice to them?
For the students, those who are still in the university, I think my advice is before you join a startup. But if you start your own startup, you better work for a startup a few months, if possible, 1 or 2 years, get experience and learn something. Because I have seen a lot of arrogant and stupid founders nowadays. They don't know what they're doing actually, and they're making the whole market collapse because of the the prices and all these things. You develop something, this smart skin, so somebody come there and they say, oh, he give you 10 ringgit, I can do it for 5 ringgit. So he's making the market actually bad. And then again, actually, he know that it's not sustainable because he's young, he don't have experience, so you don't know that actually.
But I think the market can because it's not sustainable, it's going to clean this, it's going to select the
patient. Yeah, but then again they will be very demoralized, so that's why I'm telling that you don't fail that fast. If you have some experience, you will not fail actually, you will sustain, because if like this, like you start fast a startup and 2 years, I have did 3 years startup all failed, then nobody want to hire you also in the job. So I don't want them to do that actually. So better work for companies or start up for a few days.
For a few years, get experience, network. I think it's very wise advice. Mehdi Hassan, thank you very much for joining us on Startup Zone.
Okay, no problem. Thanks. Thank you. Bye.
And our audience, thank you for watching, and we will see you next week with another amazing guest like Hassan. So thank you, and see you. Bye.